I was gonna do another Well I Watched list at the start of next year, but because I enjoyed making the first list as much as I did, and I had all these new movies and shows that I wanted to talk about, I decided to split this video into two parts, with part one being what I watched from January to June, and part two will be what I watched from July to December, so hopefully that video will be up before February this time. Before we start though, if you enjoy the stuff that I do here and you like this video, it'd be awesome if you would consider subscribing. I'm trying to grow my channel, and all you have to do is hit that big red subscribe button to help me out. You can always unsubscribe later if you change your mind. I started off the year by watching Wonder Woman 1984. A lot of people seem to have a lukewarm reaction to this film, but I actually really enjoyed it. I thought it was a nice throwback to those classic superhero movies like the original Superman or the 2000 Spider-Man trilogy. I'll say that while the first movie is still, I think, the superior for the most part, this one definitely had the better ending, and that's just not even an argument as far as I'm concerned. 8 out of 10. After that, I started watching WandaVision as it aired weekly on Disney Plus, and I actually really, really liked the sitcom part of the series, but I also didn't hate it when the show transitioned into being half sitcom, half your typical Marvel fodder. This was probably the most fun I had with a Marvel project to come out that wasn't an Avengers movie since Thor Ragnarok. 8 out of 10. Then I watched HBO's The Outsider. This was something I was actually really excited for because the premise of the novel from Stephen King sounded very intriguing to me. So when I heard that it was getting a TV adaptation from HBO, I knew it was something that I'd have to watch, and I'm glad to say that I was not let down by this. This mystery thriller far exceeded my expectations, and I love the way this whole series played out. Every little bit of information is important, and while sometimes the explanations can seem a little out there and a bit ridiculous to wrap your mind around, the series somehow makes the supernatural elements of the story grounded in reality and actually believable. Am I allowed to call myself a Stephen King fan if I don't read the books? 9 out of 10. Around mid to late last year, I started Netflix's The Dragon Prince and finished it in February. I was pretty surprised by how much I actually enjoyed this series, but of course from a show by the makers of Avatar and Korra, that probably should have been obvious. Aside from some occasional humor directed at children under the age of 10 and some rather choppy animation in the first season, but the first season alone, I have very little negative to say about this series. This is a show that focuses on the morality of war, and that was the most shocking part about it to me. They hold very little back in their depiction of what war can bring. There is death in the series, a lot more death than you'd probably expect from a children's Netflix show. There are good characters that have done bad things, and that is a very big focus of the series. Nobody is perfect, and that is okay, because that's how it has been and always will be. The best thing that anyone can do is what they think is right. I won't go on for too long here because there is a lot to say about the ground that this series lays out, and I admire the creators and showrunners for treating things like this as maturely as they did. If there actually is a fourth season coming that will bring more to the table, I'm looking forward to it. 8 out of 10. Shortly after that, I watched the second season of Be the Beginning. I watched season 1 way back when it first came out on Netflix in America, and much of the reason I enjoyed it is still here in the second season. Season 1 was 12 episodes long, while season 2 is only 6, but that actually seems to work in the series' favor. It's obvious that this is a setup for a season 3, but I'm mostly just glad that this season justified its existence since the first season more or less wrapped up with very few loose ends. The action scenes and the gorgeous animation here are just as amazing as Season 1, and I hope Season 3 doesn't take another 3 years to get here. 8 out of 10. After that, I watched Lupin the Third, the First. I've been interested in the Lupin the Third series for a while now, but I'd never actually sat down and watched the show or any of the films. So when I heard that a new CG movie was coming out, and that the reviews for the film were already looking amazing, I decided this was probably my best jumping off point. And I'm glad that I took it, because this is one of the most fun adventure films I have seen in a long time. All the characters here, both the main characters and the villains, were super fun to watch as they went on this grand and rather ridiculous quest to find an ancient artifact that could potentially hold the power to end the entire world. Lupin himself is as charming as he is clever and scheming, but of course he's impossible to actually hate from the first moment that he's on screen. He and his crew have this amazing chemistry that's just super well done, and it's super fun to watch them bicker over how they're gonna get themselves out of this. And of course the animation in this movie just looks absolutely amazing, but if I talk about it too much, then I'll be here longer than I probably should for a series that I have yet to actually get invested in. After this, I might just have to get into one of the older Lupin series, and if a sequel is in the works, then I will be here when it eventually comes out. 8 out of 10. Then I watched The Falcon and the Winter Soldier, and I think I enjoyed this even better than WandaVision for one key reason. This show puts its biggest focus on its characters, and how they develop over the course of the events that take place in this series. Bucky and Sam don't interact or even meet up until the second episode of the series, and that is an amazing choice. If this was a movie, there would be no way we would get a subplot about Sam and his sister trying to figure out what to do with their parents' boat. We wouldn't get this story that focuses on the lower class and the immigrants that are being screwed over by the government pushing aside the quote-unquote less important members of the world who got screwed over by the snap. We wouldn't have Sam trying to understand the motivation and shift the ideals of a terrorist organization that is literally fighting for human rights. We wouldn't get a terrorist organization that fights for human rights! Yes, some of the dialogue can be cheesier on the nose. Yes, John Walker's redemption could have used work. Yes, Zemo was amazing, and I don't care that he didn't seem exactly exactly like he did in Civil War. WandaVision gave me hope that these Disney Plus Marvel shows could do what the movies couldn't, and Falcon and the Winter Soldier just solidified that point for me. Long tangent short, the things that this show did good, it did fucking amazingly, and the lows are not low enough for me to give a shit. 9 out of 10. And then for the first time since Sonic the freaking Hedgehog, I finally went back to theaters to see Godzilla vs. Kong, and goddamn, it was worth seeing this on the big screen. This film is nothing groundbreaking, but what do you expect? It is 2 hours of monsters doing monster stuff while occasionally fighting each other in some of the best shot fight scenes in the entire MonsterVerse. The human story in this one is probably the worst that it has ever been, if I'm being honest, but I guess I was just able to overlook that and enjoy the things that this movie does do well. The best compliments I can give are probably the CG and, as I said, the fight scenes are probably at their best in the entire MonsterVerse. This is genuinely one of the most beautiful films I have watched this year, which is so weird to say, but I loved both the monsters here, and as far as I'm concerned, there is a clear winner between the two, and you know who doesn't show up until after the winner has already been shown. 8 out of 10. Needing a show to binge, I decided to watch Erased, and this show hit me so off guard. It didn't take me long at all to get invested in this world's story and characters, and the animation is so good. I don't know what it is, but this show's animation just does it for me. This series is another edge-of-your-seat mystery thriller with supernatural elements that the show still manages to ground in reality, although this time it's actually the protagonist who has the powers rather than it being the killer. I won't spoil anything here, but this show was exactly what I needed when I watched it. And it's shows like this that remind me why I love anime. 9 out of 10. To follow up a murder mystery, it only makes sense that I followed it up with Monty Python and the Holy Grail after several months of a close friend of mine insisting that I needed to watch this. And yes, she was right. Some of the funniest shit to me has always just been super dry and sarcastic humor, and so basically just British humor kills me whenever I watch it. So this movie was exactly what I was looking for. There's really not much for me to say except for this already being in the running for the funniest thing that I saw this year. 9 out of 10. Then, out of nowhere, Netflix dropped The Mitchells vs. The Machines, and I needed to watch it immediately. I have been looking forward to this movie for well over a year now, and I am so glad that they gave the cool name back to have more people give this movie the attention it deserves. Another movie in the running for funniest thing that I've seen. I loved literally every second of this movie, and that is not an exaggeration. This is one of the most beautiful animated movies I've ever seen. I would expect nothing less from Lord and Miller, who I am slowly realizing are also super good at doing animated dads, like Flynn from Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, Will Ferrell in the Lego Movie, and Miles' dad from Spider-Verse. Despite my expectations for this movie, it still managed to far exceed them. Whatever it is that Sony does next, Spider-Verse and Mitchells have officially made me more excited to see what they work on in the future, and Spider-Verse 2 cannot fucking get here soon enough. 10 out of 10. Then another one that my friend kept recommending me to watch this year was Puellae Magi Modica Magica, and fucking Christ. From the first 3 episodes, this show gets into your head and fucks with you on so many levels. I have never seen another magical girl anime, but it is obvious how much this show subverts all the tropes that you would expect from that genre. I really don't know what else to say from this show, aside from just how good it is at sucking you in and making you feel paranoid and hopeless without making you want to stop watching, because you feel that you owe it to yourself to see how everything will end. The few twists that are in this show are built up so well, and by the time they're officially revealed to you, you've probably already assumed that they're true, but being told you're right is actually gratifying, rather than I called it because that was obvious moment. I'm looking forward to finding more great anime like this and Erased this year. 9 out of 10. I binged the entire second season of Netflix's Love, Death, and Robots in a single 2-hour sitting, and I thought it was amazing. I loved season 1 back when it first came out, though some of the episodes were definitely more forgettable than others. While not every episode of this volume was perfect either, that does not take away from my enjoyment of this. Every single episode has amazing animation, from photorealism to hyper-stylized. The main standout episodes to me were Ice, which had amazing stylized character and world design, Pop Squad, which I would gladly watch an entire season worth of episodes of for its intriguing world building and morality dynamic, and All Through the House for being short but memorable and also made a hilarious Christmas special. I'm glad to see Netflix is putting faith in the series and that they have already confirmed that a third volume will be coming out same time next year. I'm looking forward to seeing what these amazing writers and animators cook up for us next year. 9 out of 10. And then I remembered Hulu was releasing MODOK, so I decided to give that show a try, and this has no right to be as good as it is. I watched a bit of Robot Chicken years back when my mom, brother, and I were moving apartments and temporarily lived with my grandparents. My brother and I would stay up late enough to watch Adult Swim for an hour or so, and every so often we catch a new episode of season 1 of Rick and Morty, or whatever season Robot Chicken had going on at the time. While I found the show humorous enough, it was always the stop-motion animation that I was most impressed with. I am a whore for stop-motion animation, and you can thank Nightmare Before Christmas and Fantastic Mr. Fox for that. So when I first saw the trailers for MODOK, I was pretty excited to see it was being made by the team behind Robot Chicken. So, to get that out of the way quickly, yes, this show is absolutely gorgeous. I absolutely have to shout out the way MODOK's mouth is animated. I'm not 100% certain whether or not most characters actually have stop-motion animated mouths, but MODOK definitely does. And it is so well done. Everything about this show's production is just amazing. The animation, the voice acting, the background antics, the countless upon countless Easter eggs in every single episode. I was surprised by just how much fun I had while watching this, and I just fell in love with all of these characters, even if they only appeared in a single episode. Gary and Lou need to be protected at all times. I love them so much. I was even surprised they had the balls to end the season on a huge cliffhanger that actually has me super excited for a season 2, which I hope and pray we do get without having to wait super long for. But no matter how long we do have to wait for a second season, I will be there for it when it finally gets here. 9 out of 10. And while I do wish that I could end this list with something like Luca or Godzilla Singular Point due to some personal, rather life-changing events that I will not go into, the entire second half of the month of June, I was always busy with either work, family stuff, or this personal major life-changing event. Those of you in the know, you know exactly what I am talking about. But before this video ends, I want to say that both those I do plan on watching, as well as all the other Disney Plus series that have yet to finish but I have very much enjoyed so far. Loki and The Bad Batch are genuinely both fucking amazing, and I look forward to finishing both of those series when they do finally wrap up. I'm also looking forward to the second season of Beastars, The Suicide Squad, Shang-Chi, Spider-Man Far From Home, Marvel's What If, and a bunch of stuff that I've probably forgotten are even coming out this year. Here's hoping that the second half of the year turns out just as good as the first one. Andy, I am begging you, please don't let us down with Venom 2. Thank you all for watching, and I hope to see you in part 2 in January. Yes, I promise to upload between now and then.